Good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received no apologies for today's meeting and we're joined online by Paul Sweeney. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private and whether to take equivalent items in private at future meetings. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session on the independent review of gender identity services for children and young people commissioned by NHS England and implications for the future provision of gender identity services in Scotland. And I welcome to the committee Rhoda McLeod, Head of Adult Services, Sexual Health, Police Custody and Prison Healthcare, Sandyford Sexual Health Service from Greater Glasgow and Clyde. Tracy Gillis, Medical Director of NHS Lothian, and we are expecting Dr Amelia Crichton, Director of Public Health, also from Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And we'll move straight to questions, and David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to panel members. Can the witnesses detail the differences and similarities between Scotland and England in terms of approach of care and treatment of young people with gender dysphoria incongruence?
Who'd like to start?
Who'd like to go first?
It's a bit of a PhD level question, isn't it? So yeah. In terms of the differences between Scotland and England, a lot of the differences about how healthcare is organised are different across multiple services within England. I haven't worked in England for 30 years, so I'm less familiar with their exact mechanisms for commissioning services. But within Scotland, we try to take a very collaborative approach, I think, between different areas who are delivering healthcare service. So Glasgow and Lothian would try and work together wherever possible, to avoid duplicating where there's scarce expertise. So for the youngest people, Greater Glasgow and Clyde has been the provider of service in terms of the assessment of gender incongruence. And then between Glasgow and Edinburgh, i.e. NHS Lothian, any treatment that has been provided in terms of puberty suppressing hormones has been done between the East and the West Coast. Perhaps I should stop there and then you might have some further questions because it was a very broad question to start with.
I can just add a bit to that. So I think it's fair to say that gender identity services for young people have all evolved fairly similarly internationally. And I don't think Scotland's exceptionally different in that respect. We have evolved in a similar way in terms of it's grown organically. It's not been designed and then developed from a specific design. So it's the same as England in that respect. We have one assessment site currently within Scotland, which was similar to England in terms of the Tavistock. But I can't comment on the Tavistock's clinical interventions, but what I can say in terms of what we do in Greater Glasgow and Clyde is a pretty robust assessment process where we do spend considerable amount of time with young people throughout that process of assessment. But the kind of model that exists in Scotland currently is not that dissimilar in terms of you have an assessment process and then there are links with paediatric endocrinology, or there are links currently with those that are still currently on medication, and there have been these links, and obviously as time progresses in terms of service developmentally, then these links will obviously continue.
What are the main challenges of meeting the recommendations of the CAS report in Scotland?
Okay, well, there's a lot of recommendations of the CAS report in Scotland. I think there are developing the right service model that's inclusive, that engages with young people and offers a service at a more local level, that offers that opportunity for young people to start to talk about their gender questioning issues, that encompasses a holistic assessment approach that also has expertise around neurodevelopmental conditions, rather than it being one
area just now of assessment process or one service that does that. Other challenges, I would say, are staffing and recruitment. It's an ongoing problem, has been an ongoing problem for the Young People Service to recruit staff into the service, and that will remain challenging. I would see that the introduction of a Scottish approach to what CAS recommends would be beneficial in terms of offering that foundation for us to build a service properly, and would encourage, I would say, be a positive thing in terms of encouraging staff into it. So staffing, identifying what the actual multidisciplinary team should consist of, what the regional structure should consist of, but what also should be around rather than NHS services, because this is not just, I know this discussion is about the NHS response to gender questioning young people, but it is a very broad issue and there are other services that have responsibilities, and I think Cass mentioned that in her report as well in terms of the wider system. This is not just about what one specialist service can offer this group of young people.
Tracy?
Yes, so I think taking a Scotland-wide approach is a very sensible place to start. There are lots of things that we need to make sure we do in a similar way. So how healthcare records are changed, when that happens, how that feeds forward into the rest of the system. We don't want to have a piecemeal approach around that. I think that point about the multidisciplinary team is really important. Who should be there, and how do we make that something that is truly person-centred, so bringing together different elements around an individual, but that it doesn't become a hold-up to progression for the individual. That's difficult in all areas where multidisciplinary teams work, and I actually don't know that this is going to be any different. That is always a challenge.
No further questions.
Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. Declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. Good morning, panel. Given the recommendations to move to a regional model to provide gender services, do you have GPs sitting on your panel who will input into the service design? And I'm very specifically asking about a GP on the panel in the room at every meeting and not just consulted or asked for input.
So I think it's too early for me to comment on that at the moment, in terms of we absolutely will want to make sure that we're really thoughtful about the place for primary care and general practice specifically within primary care, within the ongoing care of individuals. I know that for many GP colleagues, this is an area where there have been challenges in the past about prescribing, and in particular people wanting to make sure that any prescribing is within something that they as a prescriber would feel comfortable about. So I think there will be a place for many different professional groups within that multidisciplinary team. And yeah,
question. So, okay, you might not have a panel, but will you guarantee there will be a GP that sits on that panel in every meeting when it comes to service design?
I think what I would want to understand is what you would expect that the panel would be doing, because a panel to me implies a sort of a very yes-no decision, and I don't think that's what good holistic care and multidisciplinary care will look like. Do I think there will be a place for somebody to bring a general practice perspective into discussions about individuals in the right context? Yes, I do. Do I think there will be a place for wider primary care members within that discussion also? Yes, I do.
Thank you.
Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. Just a quick question came to my mind. Do you know if NHS Scotland will be taking part in the review of adult gender services as recommended by CAS across NHS England? Will there be some connection between NHS England and NHS Scotland on that?
I'm not aware of that. I think what would be important would be for people with responsibility around clinical governance and around how services develop to keep their eyes on how services change in other areas. So what happens as a result of that review in England? What changes are proposed? How are they implemented? And then to consider, is that relevant for the context within Scotland, NHS provision and wider provision? A little bit like has been done to date by the Chief Medical Officer's review of the implications for CAS. What does that mean? Which of those recommendations are relevant for Scotland and which ones are less relevant because of differences in the models?
Can I just maybe add to that?
So I don't think there are plans for that at this point in time. I agree entirely with what Tracy's just said. I think if we're redesigning services for young people across Scotland, then it begs the question, it naturally asks the question, well, what do adult services look like? Because they're not separate. They are separate, but they're not. And it's not different to any other clinical service that has, you know, a children's aspect or young people's aspect to it, and there's an adult service. You need to look at the transitions. You need to look at the service models. You need to make sure that the flow between the two services actually works. So I think it would be a natural progression, in my opinion, for Scotland to look at the adult service on the back of what is designed for young people. So the two need to happen, my recommendation.
Thank you.
Thank you. And before I start my questions, I'll refer members to my register of interest. I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. We had Dr. Cass at committee on the 7th of May, and we did ask her about some of the criticisms that there's been of the methodology that she used. And I'm sure the panel are aware that since she gave her evidence to the committee, the BMA has voted in favour of a motion which asked the BMA to publicly critique the CAS review. And then subsequently they created a task and finish group. So I'm interested to know, to what extent do the witnesses accept that the CAS report is based on sound scientific methodology, or do you have any concerns?
Yes. So my understanding is that the University of York provided the critical appraisal of the evidence. They have a strong track record in looking at evidence, understanding how that evidence has been gathered, and then bringing a perspective to that that has the sort of scientific basis that we would expect to see in any other area of clinical practice. So the University of York do have a strong reputation for doing this. So my perspective would be that the review has asked people with expertise, academic expertise in appraising the evidence in totality to do that. So I would be able to, I would place a level of reliance on that methodology.
Rhoda, do you want to add anything?
I would agree entirely with what's just been said. The other additional comment I would make in reference to the recent discussions that have been happening within the BMA is the BMA are not a clinical organisation, they're a staff-side organisation, and they're entitled to have their own views and perspectives on it. But obviously we would adhere to what the clinical perspective is, and that's what we're doing.
So in regard to that, so how would you anticipate that provision of services would respond to findings of the BMA's evaluation in the event that its findings are at odds with those of the CAS review?
I think we would need to find out what they have to say first, and then we would have to look at the evidence and take it from there.
Tracy, anything?
I would have to agree. Whilst obviously a trade union's perspective onto something is something that we would want to consider, I don't think that we would necessarily pay, you know, we would consider that with the methodology by which it's been done, I think. I think sound clinical practice takes all views, looks at those, but understands what is the evidence base that they've been drawn from, how has that view been developed, and we need to place differential weight on different strengths of evidence.
So, do witnesses agree with the BMA's call for implementation of the CAS review recommendations to be paused pending the conclusion of its task and finish group, which is expected towards the end of this year?
I don't agree with that, no.
Okay, thank you very much. Joe Fitzpatrick.
Just, very, very briefly, in terms of the view from the BMA about a critical review. Normally when scientific research is taken forward, the ultimate test of that research's robustness is a peer review process. And apart from the University of York, which I think was probably a partner rather than a peer review, are you aware of that having happened before the publication of the CASH review? Because normally that would happen, you know, before someone publishes a paper in Nature or something like that, there would be this peer review.
So peer review would be a normal process around an individual publication of a scientific finding as opposed to a synthesis of evidence. There's a lot of methodology around how evidence is appraised, and that was my understanding about what York had done. They're not publishing a specific new finding as a scientific paper. They're looking at the papers that other people have done. We apply exactly that methodology within other areas of Scotland, within signed guidelines, you know, within Healthcare Improvement Scotland, to have that responsibility for looking at the evidence. Within signed guidelines, there is an approach that looks at the way that evidence has been brought forward. There's also quite a lot of science behind how you look for evidence to make sure that you do gather in as much evidence as possible. You'll probably be aware from other evidence that's been given to you about other topics that it's a really important source of concern that sometimes trials related to new therapies in completely different areas of medicine are not published, and therefore that evidence is not there. So I would follow what would be the expected scientific discipline in this area.
Any thoughts either on why there does appear to be a difference between this evidence you've said is there, it's been done by other people, and it's just been distilled in a particular way within the CAS review to come to the conclusions that CAS has come to, and I've got no medical training, so I'm not going to question that at all, but it does appear that people with similar qualifications and medical experience in other countries have come to very different conclusions. Any thoughts on that? I mean, it's never black and white, is it?
Well, I think that's what I mean about this is an important signal, but we need to really apply the same standards as we would do in other areas of practice. And if there are mixed views about what good practice looks like, and I'm trying very definitely not to say treatment, I'm trying to say what good practice looks like in a holistic way, then it's absolutely important that we consider that, but we're sort of wanting to add that in about it might bring additional views, but it at the end of the day, where we are sometimes around individuals moving to a treatment phase, we need to be sure that that is safe and that that is based on sound evidence.
Yeah, that's really helpful. Thank you. Well, I move on to my next. Please. So, you mentioned treatment, so I'm going to home in now on one area of treatment where there's obviously concern. Hormone treatments. Obviously, under the prior to the assessment of CAS, there were a relatively small number of young people who received hormone treatment. You know, from the significant numbers who come for support, relatively small number receive treatment, and currently that's been suspended. So I guess just to hear your thoughts on what that means for those young people, just to expand the question a little bit, I'm aware of constituents who, even under the previous system, were going and accessing hormone treatment by private means, with all the risks that legal private means, but nonetheless with all the risks of not being able to get the support in terms of ongoing assessment of the hormone levels. So I just to ask what you think the implications of the current restriction will have on young people going forward.
Just for clarification about what type of hormone treatment you mean.
I think just the ones which have been restricted. So probably puberty blockers are the ones which are part of that, but that's quite coarse language, isn't it?
No.
But no. So that would be the one that, yeah.
So There's something really important about making sure that we're talking about the same thing. So the suppression of puberty is using drugs which are not licensed for that. And that's a really important part of the beginning of this, is that for a prescriber to use a drug outside the terms of its licence brings additional responsibilities. And I think that's set out quite clearly, actually, and helpfully in the CMO's report. I think the issue about the suppression of puberty is that it has very little... And this is where we're into the appraisal of the evidence again. We know that puberty is a physiological process, and so the suppression of that is likely to have physiological consequences, some of which are known, some of which are postulated but not yet evidenced. So making sure that the assessment process leading to such an intervention needs to have really quite significant rigour, and that the shift that there has been following CAS is it's really very difficult to articulate why any prescriber might want to undertake that step. I think that's how I would see it.
Okay.
The part about prescribing outside a specialist service, I think, has a number of very significant concerns. Now, I understand that many people have sought care because they don't feel that the NHS has been meeting their needs. And that is really important for us to acknowledge and then think more carefully, how do we provide that support for individuals in a way that does consider all their needs?
So I think that's really helpful in terms of distinguishing the difference between puberty blockers and other hormonal treatment. Is other hormonal treatment, has that been restricted as well?
I think, yes. Sorry, Rona.
Yes, so for under 16, 17-year-olds, gender-affirming hormones, it's been paused as well, unless they're already in clinical care and receiving puberty suppressants, and then we'll go on to that if that is a decision. So to answer to your first question about what's the implications for people, I don't think we can underestimate that for a small number of people this is not insignificant. I think we'd have to acknowledge that, and it's been distressing for them, and obviously we'd try our best in the service to support people who are in that position, because the decision was made quite suddenly and we have a small number of people who are ready to actually progress treatment, and that has been paused. So I think it's right to acknowledge that that's very distressing for these individuals and their families. I think we have to weigh up what the situation we have with what Tracy's just said in terms of the clinical risks and what we don't know. We don't know what the benefits truly are. People tell us, we have reports of people saying this is beneficial, but systematically, we don't know what the benefits are and what truly the risks are. And working in that uncertainty isn't good. So we actually have to put some controls on this. And the plan, obviously, I think it was announced by government minister just a couple of weeks ago about us engaging with the English research in terms of clinical trials. And that's where most drugs, and Tracy knows much more about this than me, about how clinical trials work. But that's how most new medication would be managed and administered to children or to young people. So the impact for a small number of people is quite great. I think we need to remember you've got the information there, but there's over 1,000 people, young people, on the waiting list, and we can't assume that all these young people are sitting waiting to get puberty blockers. And one of the problems is that the waiting list is so great, by the time they get seen by a clinician, they're way past that stage where they could actually be prescribed these drugs anyway, because they're actually in puberty or they're too old to receive them. There's something we need to do about that aspect of the care in terms of how we support young people at an early stage and design services. So the medical pathway is very much top end of this. I think I would want the committee to know as well is that, you know, our numbers in Scotland are low, but the numbers in Scotland are low partly to do with the fact that we don't have a big service and we don't have a lot of staff working in it. So I think we can't draw conclusions about numbers from this because of the complexities and the challenges that the service has faced over the years.
Can I just add something to that? And that is one of the things that, and because the assessment for the 16s and unders takes place in the Sandiford, Rhoda has more information than this that I do, but the emerging picture of a number of individuals with other health conditions, so with neurodevelopmental diagnoses, and for some of them with mental health conditions, I think puts a greater onus on the need to treat the individual in a very... it should be truly person-centred care. It should be about bringing those different aspects together and making sure that enough support has been provided for the other aspects as well, rather than jumping to just dealing with one element of the care for that individual. And I would have to say that I think that is something locally which we have got more work to do about. Any local MSPs will know that we have got longer waits than we would want to see about our neurodevelopmental pathways. And I think that separating the different elements of this around an individual are likely to be disadvantageous to the individual. So we need to do more work to integrate those services more than they are currently.
So I think some of my colleagues might want to probe a little bit more on that holistic aspect, which I think is really important. So that's been really helpful, I think, in terms of laying out some of that points. But for some young people, they will feel that this is the treatment for them, and they feel that they've been denied even being clinically assessed for that treatment. So obviously the trial for them will be a ray of hope in terms of getting that support. So obviously it's a UK-wide trial, which is normal for medicines. That's the way that they're done. But is there a route in for young Scottish folk to access the trial when it, and do you know the timetables? And maybe is there a thought on what it would look like?
Can join us shortly because she's been involved in engagement. Right. But the plan, my understanding is the plan is for, yes, young Scottish people to be involved in the clinical trials.
Okay. Any thought, any understanding of timescales?
Not at this point in time, because it will depend. Obviously, it's been led by NHS England or the National Institute for Health Research, so that they govern the timescales in respect to that.
That
I think
it will
be into. I think my understanding. I think it will probably be into next year, probably.
Okay. Thank you,
Gillian McKay.
Thanks, convener. Rhoda, you mentioned earlier on that distress for those young people who were very close to accessing that treatment. How is that being monitored with these young people and their families, and what support is there in place for them? I know a great many of them are very distressed, and that mental health impact on some of these young people will be very great.
So people obviously that we're prioritising in the service just now are those that are currently in our care and are seen by our psychology team. So they are continuing to be monitored by our staff at Sandiford and supported appropriately. If we feel that they require additional support, we would obviously connect them into other services, but they are being monitored and worked with and supported as best we can under the circumstances.
That's great. What work's being done to reduce some of the wait times at the moment as well? Because as well as those young people who have now had their treatment pathways changed because of a decision that's out with their control, there are many, many other young people who are waiting a very long time to be able to access these services too.
It's really, really challenging. Okay, we really struggle to recruit staff into this service. We struggle to recruit staff into the adult service, but because of the nature of the young people service and the publicity around it, that it gives us an extra layer of challenge that doesn't happen so quite so much in the adult service. And our problems with recruiting into the service means that we struggle to take people off the top of the waiting list. What we have been focusing on is doing a clinical validation exercise where we are speaking to all the young people who are currently waiting and to find out how they are, checking out with them essentially, why they're on the list and they still want to be on the list, and how are they functioning, how are they doing, and do they need some additional supports whilst they're waiting. So that's actually been quite a successful bit of work. Young people have valued that. They've valued getting the phone call and an opportunity to be spoken to rather than hanging in the ether somewhere. Some of the statistics we're getting back, though, from that are really, really informative and really interesting. It's back to, and I don't, you mentioned people wanted to ask more questions about the nature of the population, but there's some good data we're getting back in terms of about the mental health of these individuals and neurodevelopmental conditions and their natal sex as well. Who is it that's on this list? Who's waiting? And one of the challenges we had, Sandyford, was... Because Sandyford is a sexual health service, and it has a full range of services. The gender service just comprises one part of what Sandyford does, and it is an open door service. So historically, the adult and young people's gender service evolved in the same way when it was self-referral. We would get referrals in from professionals as well to young people's service, but a lot would be self-referrals, but we didn't know anything about them. Obviously, they would just give us their name and say they wanted to be on the list. And I think one of the biggest challenges for us and important things is we get to grips with who's on our list and are they being supported and what and getting the right information about them and knowing who is on that list and how best they can be supported. And actually, I think this will help to inform proper service development nationally as well. So I'm afraid my answer to your question is not perhaps what you'd hope for. We're not in a position where we're able to reduce this waiting list quickly. I think, therefore, it calls for a creative solution in terms of nationally about what should this service look like? What should that first entry level be for a young person who's gender questioning? And if you have it, all roads lead to Sandyford, then it wouldn't matter where you had it, whether you had it in Glasgow, Edinburgh, whether you put it in Inverness, you have it in one centre, you're going to have the same problems. There needs to be more of a dispersed model that has a tiered approach and has a range of services that young people can access and gives them time to explore options rather than all focusing in one place, which actually we would just recreate the same problem if we did that.
And I think there's many young people who would prefer to have their treatment much closer to home and not have to travel and things as well. And I know a few young people who very much endorse that work, and that brings its own challenges in terms of wait times, putting it out there as well. I wanted to come back to the young people who have obviously had their treatment pathways changed because of the pause in prescriptions. Are you getting a sense at the moment of what that impact is from these young people? Because I think I'm really keen that we keep these young people's views and experiences at the front of what's going on during that service redesign piece of getting it out more regionally, but also the ongoing impact and harm to them.
Kind of double whammy, I suppose, for these individuals. The fact the services, the health boards have made a decision to pause this treatment at this point in time, or referrals into this treatment. But then, obviously, there's the wider UK decision about private prescribing, because a lot of people then would go, well, we'll source it privately, and that's kind of for very good reasons as well, being stopped. But and then there's people then might take additional risks and try to start sourcing things overseas. So there are risks associated with this, you know, where people will try in desperation, I suppose, to find the drugs that they feel they need. And we have to manage that and support that and advise people accordingly of the dangers of doing that.
Okay. Thanks, Camina.
Carol Morgan.
Camina, I'm interested to know, in terms of hormone treatments, if people... the example I have is if a female is placed on testosterone, you know, how we make sure people understand what the potential risks of that are in terms of osteoporosis, and you have much better clinical in-depth knowledge of these kind of things. But has been raised with me, do we know that people can access things like bone density scans and those kind of things as they go on through their life journey?
So if we're thinking about individuals, and it's really puberty suppression that has that evidenced impact onto bone density, then that, I think that does is an important aspect of the transition into adult services that we remain sighted on the need to provide that. So that would be a good example of where we need to make sure we've got primary care involved in how the lifelong journey around that individual's care is developed. In terms of the information that we're giving to people at the start of medical treatment, I think there are always opportunities to improve that information and to make sure that's kept up to date with current knowledge. It's a lot to take in. Usually at any consultation, the information that's being provided to you about possible treatment options and the risks and consequences of those. And I think one of the things that we know from other areas of practice is where people have waited a long time for something, that they understandably invested in the treatment option that they think they're coming towards. And it means that when they're taking part in a discussion about possible risks and benefits, that sometimes what they hear is somebody trying to put them off or trying to sort of almost be a barrier. And I think it's probably more important in this type of decision about treatment, where the evidence base over the very long term is still lacking, that we are careful about how we provide that information, and we give probably multiple opportunities to think about questions that people have, wanting to be able to explore that. And that is right and proper. It just becomes very hard to do that in a service which is under pressure about waiting times. So those two things really come into conflict, and we all need to think carefully about how we address that. My points about how information is provided and how people are given an opportunity to go away and think about that, to test that out in their own minds, I would say that is not unique to this area of clinical practice. That is the same in many other areas of clinical practice.
Okay, that's lovely. Thank you very much.
Gillian McKay.
I think you've already had me.
Okay, Tess White.
Thank you. Tracy, are you saying that much more work needs to be done in terms of exploring the impact on someone who takes the suppressant hormones, and it could impact childbearing, it could impact, there have been cases where incontinence and also detransitioning. Are you saying that really does need quite a bit more work on the impact?
So I think that would be the purpose of a research study, would be to do something within a structured way where we can get longer-term follow-up about the consequences for individual, and those may be very positive consequences in terms of their well-being, as well as potentially things that are, as you say, more negative consequences.
So more work needs to be done on the risks.
And so the purpose of a research approach to this is to provide that long-term follow-up so that we know in 5 years' time or 10 years' time what has happened, rather than, and this is back to the evidence point again, where there's been quite poor or very short-term follow-up of individuals, what we don't know is what are the longer-term consequences.
Thank you, Convener.
Bahani.
If we look at the average age of puberty, it's 11 for girls and about 12 for boys-ish. His Standard 8 talks about understanding the risks and benefits of treatments and interventions. So we are asking children of 10 to understand the risks and benefits of medication that have lifelong implications which we don't fully understand yet as medical professionals, and don't have a pathway set up for. So how is there something we're going to be able to bridge?
So I think what you've articulated are the reasons why 2 years ago we wanted to really be much clearer about the indications for this type of treatment, and why we've wanted to move towards pausing, stopping this treatment at the moment, because what you're articulating is correct. So puberty suppression, the drugs that are used are licensed for the treatment of precocious puberty. So just be careful that I don't become too clinical in this space. But where individuals are showing signs of entering puberty at a much younger age than would be expected, the licensing around those drugs, that supports that prescribing. What we're not sure about is what is the longer-term consequence of use in another setting, particularly over probably what would be a longer period of time. So essentially, what are the consequences of delaying puberty? And then going through what is a less than usual physiological puberty by then adding in gender-affirming hormones into that mix. So that is precisely the reason why there's been real concern raised about the use of puberty suppressing hormones and a cessation.
Thank you.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for your evidence so far. It's been really helpful. I'd like to ask some questions about the referral process and then move on to that sort of holistic care discussion. And you did indicate in some of your responses to Gillian Mackay about this. There were figures in the press at the weekend that there were 352 under-18s referred to the Sandiford, and 130 were made by self-referral. And it's that I'm interested in exploring. It talked in that article about the youngest individual being 7 years old. And I guess it'd be helpful for committee to understand how young people and children might be self-referring. You spoke about the sort of open door policy of the clinic. What does that look like?
The numbers of that age group have always been very, very low, and they'd be referred by their parents, probably. They obviously wouldn't be referring themselves, wouldn't know how to fit that. Would be a referral probably made by a parent. And our approach at Sandiford has always been that we might talk briefly to the person, but we wouldn't make them some general advice, but we would not be taking them into the clinical service at all.
Okay, and in terms of teenagers and younger adults, are they self-referring?
They were self-referring, and we did stop this, as you're aware, in August. But yes, they did self-refer prior to that.
And what did that process look like? They referred in, and then they're on a waiting list?
They were on a waiting list, yes. And then when they got to the top of the waiting list, they would then be contacted, and we would engage with them, and we would engage with their family as well. It wouldn't just be them as individuals, but obviously their family would be part of that too.
Thank you, that's helpful to know. We spoke in answer to the first question that was posed about the need for robust assessment and, you know, that kind of holistic picture of the child or young person. What's going to be different for children and young people? I was struck by Tracy's remark about how if you've been waiting for a long time, people become very interested and are very focused on medicine or an operation rather than that whole picture. And we understand that there are lots of differing reasons that exacerbate gender distress in young people, and I think you mentioned that you're becoming more aware about neurodivergent children and young people. There's a lot in that. I'm kind of blurting it all out at you, but keen to hear more about that.
So I think that one of the recommendations that's been made by the CMO to the Scottish Government around where this service is located and removing it out of a sexual health service into a children's and young people's environment is absolutely the right thing to do, right? Where you have clinicians there who have experience and knowledge of working with young people and with children. So we know from our clinical validation exercise so far that, and that we've spoken to, as of the 8th of August, we've spoken to 420, well, we've called, contacted 422 people who are on our waiting list. That's young people across Great Glasgow and Clyde, NHS Lothian, and started speaking to Lanarkshire patients now as well. And we know that 70% of those young people have cooperated with our calls. And we know that over 70% of them are natal females. So 70% of the people on the young people's waiting list are natal females. 50% of them are reporting that they have an assessment completed for some form of neurodevelopmental issue. And just shy of a third report a diagnosis of a mental health condition. So this is a complex group of young people that needs a really good, robust, multidisciplinary team approach. And I think maybe psychologists sitting in Sandyford along, you know, with some support from others trying to manage this is one thing. CAS talks about diagnostic overshadowing, and the CMO report also talks about that, that we have a very special service and nobody else wants to touch gender because they think it's too difficult and too hard to deal with pile.
Overshadowing.
Oh, beg your pardon.
I nodded there, but
so, beg your pardon. Sorry. So, if I think the feeling is, and Cass spoke about this too, that as soon as a young person or child mentions their gender questioning, everyone goes, oh, can't deal with this. They need to go to the gender service. So they end up on a waiting list, the gender service. So some of the people that are on our waiting list, we know, are also being worked with by CAMHS. Right, so they happen to be supported by CAMHS. They might have social work intervention. That no doubt their GP is very involved with the family and supporting them, but they're sitting on a waiting list, waiting for this service. And the problem is, you then see everything through that lens, rather than looking at the entire young person or child. So actually shifting it out, put it into a holistic, a child-centred service that has the right professionals in it who have good experience in working with children and young people is absolutely the right thing to do, and I think we'd prevent that, or try and, that would really certainly tackle that issue and hopefully prevent that from happening.
This is quite challenging to see, because I understand from listening to you both, you know, the service that you're delivering and the care and expertise with which you're delivering it with, but it's quite shocking as an individual to hear that children haven't been getting the best and that there hasn't been that curiosity about why young women who are neurodivergent are, and maybe they're, I'm not talking about as individuals, I mean as a system. It's difficult, isn't it?
Well, it is. Cass talks about this. So what I've just said here about the Scottish picture chimes completely with the UK picture. It's no different. The shift in the population, the demography of who attends gender services now has been quite significant over a very short period of time. And I think that explains a wee bit about your helps, doesn't excuse or alleviate maybe your concerns, but it helps to offer an explanation about why we're kind of almost feeling we're caught in the back pedal here, and everyone's going, what? You know, where has this come from, and how have we found ourselves in this place? But it's happened. There's been quite a significant change that's happened over quite a short period of time when it comes to health care. And yeah, Tracy knows more about that than me, but that's quite significant in terms of why we find ourselves in the place we're in.
So perhaps can I just add to that? Because I think as Rhoda says, it is a significant change in a short period of time. And we know that our healthcare systems don't always do well to keep up with that type of change. And at an individual clinical level, people are absolutely trying to do their best, but it is sometimes difficult to get that slightly more distant perspective about actually what does this look like overall. And what we also know is that waiting lists have been long, too long in this area, and therefore there has been a focus on trying to reduce waiting lists. And trying to reduce waiting lists is very difficult to reconcile with offering a holistic service that allows exploration in the individual's own time about what they want and allows trust to build up so that there can be good discussion about things that are troubling that individual. And it is very difficult to deliver those types of services with where a high trust level is needed in a very efficient way, because inevitably people have holidays, people are absent from work. And so if you're relying on those relationships which allow really genuine exploration about questioning and support for whatever decision is made in a way that is with the provision of good information that allows the individual to make their own decisions, it is very, very hard to do that in a way that is trying to move people through a waiting list process within time constraints. And as Rhoda mentioned earlier, where it is difficult to recruit staff to to an area and to build up that level of clinical expertise. So there are some real tensions in this, but actually the onus on those who are delivering service is for the standards of clinical governance in these areas to be the same as they would be in all other areas. It doesn't need to be more developed, it just needs to be as good as that. And I think what we're articulating is that there's been this very rapid shift in the population, and we need to make sure that we keep up with what is needed.
I really appreciate your candour this morning in these answers, and I think that what you're articulating there is sort of about a wider system, isn't it, and the sort of target stuff. I think I would just want to be really clear that we never get to a situation again where we're giving children and young people drugs where we don't know the benefits or risks of them and they have life-changing impacts. But thank you.
Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. My question is to Rhoda, if I may. So in your opinion, to what extent do you believe that there is true criticism of the lack of holistic care within Scotland?
But by whom?
Yeah, so you talked about organic growth and it happening in a very short place of time. So am I right to assume that the criticism that this holistic care or this person-centred care has been lacking because it's grown so quickly and so fast?
Yeah, I mean, I think the reality is, it's grown quickly. We've tried to manage a response to that. So I think, if we were to sit with a blank sheet of paper today and say, let's design a young people's gender service, I don't think we'd be saying we'd come up with, let's have it all at Sandyford and GGC. And so, and because of the way it's grown as well, and this is no disrespect to colleagues and other health boards at all, it's kind of sat within Glasgow in NHS GGC. And again, a wee bit like the too hard to deal with list in pile. Other health boards, certainly when it comes to young people, because there are other adult services that health boards deal with, but other health boards haven't decided to develop a young people's gender service, and you'd ask why not, and I think the answer is plainly obvious. Why not?
Thank you.
So it does, as back to my earlier answer, it needs a much more creative national solution here where boards are working together.
Thank you. And of those people currently at Sandyford, how many would you say are currently receiving holistic, person-centred care? Is it a small percentage, everybody?
It's only the small amount of people that actually we've got clinicians that we have in our caseload that they can see at this point in time.
Right. So it's.
I can't give you a figure. I would be making that up. Sorry.
No, that's fine. My second question, Rhoda, is so my colleague has said that children as young as seven have accessed gender services at the Sandyfords. So that's 352 children. And you have talked about the families, but in terms of that holistic, person-centred care, could you outline what involvement parents of the children and young people have and will have as the delivery of gender services changes? So the, your view of the family and the parents?
As we develop into the new model?
Well, the current and the new.
The current. Well, we do engage with clinicians. So to just be clear for committee, I'm not a clinician. So I manage the service, so I can't tell you because I've never taken a patient through this care personally. But I do know that our clinicians work very closely with families and all other professionals that are involved in a young person's life. This is not something we do in isolation, and we make sure that our assessments are as robust and as holistic as they can be within the resources that we have at Sandyford.
Thank you.
Going forward, we would obviously want to inform and support the development of a really good, robust process wherever the service may end up being located.
And then my third question to Tracy. So we've talked about, or we've heard from you about CAMHS and the massive pressures that CAMHS are under in terms of the amount of years, well, sometimes years, to actually be seen. And GPs are saying to us, a number of GPs are saying they don't have the resource under the 2018 GMS contract to treat patients with gender dysphoria. And a number of GPs have come forward. They just don't have the skill set. And so that's why they're referring patients. So in your view, Tracy, is Scotland equipped to move to a more holistic approach to treating young people accessing gender services? And if it's not, what in your view needs to change? Thank you.
So I think we are trying to remain engaged with something that is changing quite quickly, and where we have quite a wide range of clinical expertise and skills distributed through multiple different clinical communities. So the general practice community, the wider primary care community, who are part of delivering that 2018 contract. And then the approach that we are taking overall to many services is to try to pick up and deliver those in a tiered way. So we provide education and support and increase competency for services that can be delivered in a much more distributed way within the community. And then we essentially, as the service tiers up and it becomes more specialised, that's where you're more likely to have to travel. So I think what we'd be describing is something that would be similar for that within gender services, recognising that there is a level of complexity. And I'm just going to come back to my point that you've picked up about CAMHS and the pressures within CAMHS and the expertise that needs to be developed to be able to provide good therapeutic interventions in that space. We already know we don't have enough people to be able to do that. So trying to do that in a more multidimensional way around gender care as well is going to be quite challenging. Tell me your face, I haven't been clear enough.
No, it's very, very clear, and thank you for your candour. I suppose in terms of recognising that the service has organically grown, recognising that it's under significant amount of pressure, recognising that it's very complex, actually moving services to already stretched NHS boards, already stretched and massively under pressure CAMHS services is a huge issue for Scotland.
Yes, but we do need to try to address this so that we give the best care to the individuals who are experiencing that gender incongruence or dysphoria. I think the separation of different elements, so thinking about gender in one place and thinking about neurodevelopmental issues or CAMHS issues in another place, that does not make for good clinical care. And so we need to address how we do that. We're just really at the start of trying to work through that at the moment.
Thank you. Thank you, Camille.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I think a lot of the information that, or a lot of the questions I had have been answered already, but I'm just thinking about the Health Improvement Scotland standards that were just published this month, actually, September 2024. And I recognise that healthcare providers will be doing the very best they can to provide the very best care at the moment. So I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are on what needs to be done with the standards that have just been published. What would be the most difficult to achieve, and how are we doing at the moment? Because we've been talking about person-centred care for years. You know, I'm a nurse myself, so we've been talking about how do we deliver individual person-centred care, and that's obviously the goal that we would be doing here. But what would you think needs to happen to ensure that we have the standards to be achieved?
So I think we need to think about underneath each standard, what sort of evidence would different stakeholders expect to see that a health board or a service delivering that care was meeting that standard. I think one of the things that is going to be hardest to do well across this is that transition of care from children and young people services to adult services, because it's very hard to be really to do good transitions around a numerical age. So that then runs the risk that we end up with maintaining a number of children and young people within a more children's orientated service, because that's where they've been looked after. That's often where their family will have then had, if we were to look forward, where their family will have had good support. And then it becomes quite a lot harder to move into the slightly less person-centred adult world. And how we do that well, I think, is going to be quite difficult to achieve.
I think designing the service model for Scotland is a challenge, and we can do it. It's about how you then take it from one centre, look at what what boards are required to do, the standards, and how is that manifested at a regional level. So it's unrealistic to ask every health board in Scotland to run a young people's gender service. That would never happen. It's not required. The numbers, although it's complex, the numbers are still pretty small nationally, right? So we need to be kind of creative in how we think about how could this be delivered a bit closer to people's homes. So obviously we have our regional structure. I mean, it's not for me to say this. This is my thoughts on it, that actually we could be working in a more regional way in terms of delivering that. I think Tracy's comments about the other challenges that are in CAMHS around neurodiversity and neurodevelopmental issues, I think we could do something quite clever around that, and because there are increasing demands on these services for these types of assessments. And is there something we could be doing jointly with CAMHS around that whole holistic assessment process? So I think actually it's good. It's great to have the standards. They set a framework for us, but it actually doesn't tell us what a service looks like. So what does the service look like? And actually, that's what people want to know. Where do I go to get help? What's the first stage of that, if I'm beginning at gender questioning? And what are the levels? What's that tiered approach of intervention? When is it right? Because not everybody that is gender questioning needs an NHS service. And that's that. I feel very strongly about that. There's lots of people that are gender questioning out there, and they're just gender questioning. They don't necessarily need an NHS service. It depends about what else is going on for them and what their level of distress is and how they're managing to cope and how they're managing to function and how are they best supported then. So what's the role of the NHS? The standards kind of set that out, but then how does that look like in the real world for people? Where are they placed? And who's responsible for them? So we're talking, and again, the CMO report's made some clear recommendations there about where that should shift to.
Just on the back of that, implementation of the standards, monitoring how it's working, how they're being delivered, dispersed model, tiered approach,
it's the process of self-assessment is going to be the approach, my understanding, as far as monitoring the implementation of the standards. Do you think is that going to be acceptable, having a self-assessment model to implement the standards or monitor how they're being implemented?
Well, I think if we're designing something pretty new, then we'd want to probably have quite robust reporting processes around how that's developing and how it's succeeding. We do a lot of self-reporting in health. We have other aspects of my work. We have formal inspections by HIS, and there's a public report that goes out, and we have action plans, and we are accountable for making sure that we deliver on the actions in these action plans. I would imagine this would be not dissimilar to what happens in sexual health, for example. We have a set of standards. We don't have to... we don't get inspections on these standards, but we have to make sure as a board that we are actually attempting our best to meet them. So I would think that we would easily put some kind of reporting mechanism in place that would be requiring boards to report on them. Yes.
Based on existing work that's already done within NHS reporting systems?
Yes, yes.
Can I just add something to that? So between... if a self-assessment is at one end and a formal inspection process through a scrutiny assurance process is at the other, there is something in the middle which is around systems providing a level of peer learning and support. So critical friends can be really helpful as you implement a new service, because people come and they can look at the evidence that you have about how you meet the standard, but then you get that shared learning where people say, well, we do it slightly differently. Have you thought about doing this? So I think there is a middle ground which could be helpful in this space.
Just a final wee question. And just in preparation ahead of today, I was reading about how it works in terms of persons accessing their GP in Australia or in Germany or in other countries. So there's opportunities for us to learn basically a worldwide approach and what works in other areas as well.
That's absolutely right. We need to do our bit of design about changing our services first, and then look within Scotland, and then we've already referenced how do we make sure that we learn within a UK setting and then more widely.
Okay, thanks.
Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. I'd like to focus my questions mainly upon the role of GPs in designing a service model, because I am deeply concerned about how this is going to play out. Designing a service model never really seems to involve GPs. Like HIS, for example, only had written evidence. So my first question, is the provision of shared care of gender identity healthcare contractual in the GMS contract?
That would vary from board to board, about depending on their shared care agreements. So shared care agreements usually refer to the provision of medicines between a specialist and primary care, a GP service. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, so the GMS contract, according to the BMA, is very clear that this is not part of shared care, that this is outside of the GMS contract of core work that GPs would provide.
Which element do you mean?
So providing monitoring and prescription of medication.
And then which medication do you mean? Because this is where...
All gender medication.
Yeah, so medicines that are used outside the terms of their licence put additional responsibilities onto the prescriber, and I think there will be quite a wide range of how GP colleagues feel able to participate in that. And I think shared care agreements are usually developed at a board level. We have a small number, but what's really important is that there is good engagement across the interface about what would be involved in that shared care agreement, which is usually drug specific.
Does a GP sit on your board to make that agreement?
Does the GP on the board?
Where that decision is being made, because you said it was board level.
Yeah, as in, what I mean by that is that the shared care agreements in NHS Lothian will be different to the shared care agreements in NHS GGC or in NHS Fife or Borders. They're quite locally specific. They're agreed through the formulary committee usually.
HIS criteria 6.1 suggests that there are local pathways to support shared care across services and settings, with flowcharts showing discharge of patients into primary care with no set gender clinic follow-up. How can we expect GPs to be able to provide that care that you spoke about earlier when you said GPs would organise the DEXA scans under such stressed circumstances?
I don't think I said GPs would organise the DEXA scans. I said that we needed to make sure we had good longitudinal care about individuals who might need that, and then we'd need to be clear about was that coming from primary care or not. That's a curtailed version. I didn't say exactly that, but that was my intention. I think this is a really difficult area for everybody to participate in, and we need to make sure that we are cognizant of people's expertise and skills, and there's probably something that looks like care that might be related to not every GP. Does that make sense? I think it's very, very difficult to develop the skills across this area. So just as within many practices, we see some individual GPs who specialise in women's health services, and essentially the distribution of patients seeking, say, contraceptive advice or menopause advice is not shared equally between GPs working within a setting. We might see some level of developing expertise within some colleagues, but what we have to be clear about is where there is a shared care agreement around prescribing, we need to be really explicit about who's doing the prescribing, what skills and competencies do they have, what are the monitoring arrangements, what is the support for answers that come out of those monitoring arrangements and escalation. And that needs quite a lot of in-depth discussion that isn't just from one GP and one practitioner. It needs multiple views to come to a plan that is safe and effective.
Can we opt out and say, no, we don't want to do this?
I say
GPs.
Yeah, no, I realise that's what you meant. I couldn't give a yes or no answer to that. So I think it's very dependent on where an individual is. We know that in more remote and rural areas, people will have a different, often longer-term relationship that involves a lot more continuity of care with a GP than in an urban setting. So I think it's very context-specific.
Okay. Changing sex in medical records potentially could be quite dangerous. So let me give you an example. Normal range of hemoglobin is different between a man and a woman. So not knowing if somebody has changed gender could lead to maybe quite significant harm occurring. So how can we ensure that this is addressed in a standardised way across the NHS in Scotland?
I think you're right. It is important to make sure we do things in a standardised and consistent way, and that essentially where we need to pick up the differences, that if we make a change around a record, there is a way to link that to new lab reference ranges, so we're clear about what those should be. It's quite a complex area, I think, and that's why I think doing it in a standard and consistent way is really important, and we need to be supported by other public bodies, not just health boards per se, to do that. So it won't just be for Public Health Scotland. There will be important implications for NSS as well around screening and who gets called for what screening. There's a multiplicity of different questions in this.
Okay. And my last question. I think there's a big difference between a patient accessing NHS care and being prescribed medication. With normally, there will be a period of follow-up and there will be lots of discussion, and a patient going to the private setting, getting an initial diagnosis, and then the GP's being asked to prescribe medication. There's a big difference between those two. So how can we ensure that there is a standardised way across the NHS for not only patient safety, but also for the safety of the clinicians involved?
So that, my understanding is that's why the private route to prescriptions in this setting has been closed off. So I'm not quite sure what your actual question is.
So there will be a point where that will open up again. And so how can we ensure that that safety is maintained?
So I think that is down to making sure that we support individual prescribers to make sure that they are comfortable with doing prescribing of a particular treatment. And if they're not, then we are able to provide the right support for the patient in saying, what does this look like for you? How do we support you through that? Nobody should be prescribing a medicine that they don't believe they're safe or competent to do.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Emma Harper.
There's just a quick question. If GPs opted out from gender care, does that mean that we would be missing the young people that do have neurodiverse issues or mental health issues? Because it's not just a black and white thing. This is about person-centred, total patient care, assessing individuals in a whole holistic way. We've been talking about a holistic approach. So I'm concerned that if there was an opt-out, we would be missing people that really need support with other conditions.
That's possibly got lost slightly in that exchange. What I was trying to say is if an individual GP is not comfortable about doing something, there's an onus on making sure that the patient at the centre of that can still access care in the right way. That's absolutely what needs to happen.
OK. And Joe Fitzpatrick.
Sorry, but on to...
On hormones that you asked
earlier. Yeah, so I'm going to go back to the questions we had earlier. We were talking about hormone treatment and the area that the other panel members gave us some answers, but thought you were more capable, Dr. Crichton, of giving us an answer around was the clinical trials and how young people in Scotland might access that and what the trial will look like. So thanks for making it along and coming in spite of the challenges.
And apologies for the mix-up with me arriving late to the committee. So... Indeed, just to recap, we need to generate, and we had Hilary Castle at the committee, and I saw the evidence she gave to you, and she stressed within the review itself the importance of generating evidence of long-term safety. Therefore, looking at Scotland and looking at the data, how many young people have accessed puberty blockers or hormones, the numbers are so small that in discussion with the Chief Scientist Office, Dr. Anna Domenicek, we agree that we need to join forces with NHS England to ensure that we do have the power to identify real effects, either positive or negative. Therefore, together with the CMO and CSO, we have written to NHS England and NIHR expressing our desire to set up the research and participate in the NHS England research. In Glasgow, I have convened a subgroup with Glasgow University and the service colleagues to see, and the R&D support to see how we can actually implement things on the ground. But again, participating and being part of the wider NHS England research. So we are at the stage where the protocol, I understand, it's just supposed to be peer-reviewed just to ensure that there is scrutiny, although there isn't a competitive kind of tendering process, but the kind of sound scientific basis needs to be followed. Therefore, once we have that, we will be looking how we implement Scotland-wide as well. So we're poised thinking what additional resources we need to put in place to enable that.
Thanks very much. As part of the trial going forward, I totally understand how you'll do a clinical trial to look at the effects of treatment. But you know, most of us, I think, will have all come across trans people who didn't manage to receive support. I can remember one man who knew that he was a man when he was pre-teenager and went through all of his life until he retired before being able to take the affirmative action on that. So that there's someone whose life has been not as full as it might have been had he had the affirmative treatment earlier. So just whether you'd be looking at that side as well of not treating.
So I think part of the whole assessment is ensuring that there's that kind of patient-centred approach to what works best for them. And that is, so there's the psychological interventions, there's the social transition, there's the medical treatment. And what we envisage is that kind of coming together with a patient to identify what would be best for them and what would actually deliver what they truly require. So we know that there will be a number of individuals that will benefit from medical treatment and surgical treatment. It's just identifying the ones that truly will have a long-term benefit.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I thank the witnesses for their evidence today? It's been very helpful to the committee. The committee intends to take further evidence from the Chief Medical Officer on the review of gender identity services for children and young people at a future meeting. The third item on our agenda is consideration of one negative instrument, personal injuries, NHS charges, amounts, Scotland Amendment No. 2, Regulations 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to amend the personal injuries, NHS charges, amounts, Scotland Regulations 2006 in order to increase the charges recovered from persons who pay compensation in cases where an injured person receives National Health Service hospital treatment or ambulance services. The increase in charges relates to an uplift for hospital and community health service inflation. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 10th of September 2024 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to the instrument. Do members have any comments? I propose that the instrument does not make that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? Thank you. At our next meeting, we'll be taking evidence as part of the committee's further scrutiny at stage 2 of the National Care Service Scotland Bill, and that concludes the public part of our meeting today.